MCQs on subunit 6 risk management. The first question. Organizations face several types of risks in pursuit of their strategic objectives. Yes, true. The risk that the treasury function in a company works directly under the chief financial officer. What is the work of treasury function, treasury department? They manage company cash, foreign exchange accounts, even cash book is with them. The treasury function works under the CFO and it manages cash, bank, short-term investments, shares, bonds, etc. So the risk that the treasury function will fail to adequately reconcile the organization's bank statement is an example of. Again, this is terrible. This is terrible. What? Treasury, the department that have the custody of the bank and cash, should not have access to reconciliation. We have agreed. Custody of cash with treasury, recording with accounting department, reconciliation must be done with someone else. An authorization to issue cash would be given to somebody else. So this is clearly something that is inappropriate. It's an operational risk, risk related to failed operations. Hazard is something natural, earthquakes, hurricanes, floods. Financial risk means interest rate that goes beyond your capacity to pay. Strategic risk, the change in the business environment and the economy that can severely impact your business. So it's clearly the operational risk. Moving forward, the risk associated with the project. Risk associated with the project will increase in direct proportion to all of the following except risk of the project, Munne. Risk of the project goes up if the duration of the project goes up. If the project takes 30 years to construct and start to become functional and operational, it's a high risk. The project risk would go up if the duration of the project is longer. The risk is higher. The volatility of cash flows associated with the project. If the cash flow is volatile, the project is risky. C. Uncertainty surrounding the impact of federal government regulation on the project. Yes. If there is uncertainty whether the federal government regulations will be in favor of the project or against, this increases the threat for this project. So A, B, C move direct in line with the risk of the project. But capital adequacy of the organization. If you have sufficient capital, if the capital adequacy goes up, you have sufficient capital, the risk goes down. All of the other one move in the same direction. If the duration of the project goes up, risk goes up. If the volatility is high, the risk goes up. If there is uncertainty, risk goes up. If there is more capital, there is adequate capital, the risk goes down. It means this moves in the opposite direction, and that's why D is the right answer. Moving on. One technique for quantitatively assessing the risk faced by an organization is to weight the monetary consequences of a potential event by its probability. First of all, I will explain what this means. Risk of default, for example, I am considering this. Risk of default is 5%. And if there is default, there is a probable loss of $100 million. So multiplying this probability of occurrence with the significance or the dollar amount of this event will give you the expected value. That's what we know. Ajil? So one technique for quantitatively assessing the risk faced by an organization is to weight the monetary consequences of a potential event by its probability. The amount by which the maximum potential loss, associated with the event exceed this weighted amount. Let me give you a whole situation. Let me just draw up that time bachega. There is a threat of minor penetration. The probability of this is about 90%. So there is a situation, a company is assessing the risk of its systems being penetrated by a hacker. There are four possible events. Minor penetration, there is 90% probability that this will happen. And the probable monetary loss is 1 million. 90% times 1 million will give you $900,000. Then there is possibility of unauthorized viewing of internal databases. It has 50 million potential loss. And the probability of this occurring is about 8%, which means, where is my calculator? Okay, got it. So 8% times 50 million, it's 4 million. And then there is just 2% probability, just to give you a weighted average number, that's 100% now. So it's 2 billion. Times 2%, we have already done this example, it's 40,000. If you add this all, 900,000 plus 4 million plus, did I take this number? 2 billion times, it's 40 million. It's 40 million basically. 40 million plus 4 million plus 900,000, it gives you 44,900,000. This is your expected loss, okay? This is your expected loss. What if the loss goes something beyond $60 million? Your expected loss was 44.9 million, an average loss that we could sustain. But the loss is up to 60 million. So back to the question, one technique for quantitatively assessing the risk faced by an organization is to weight the monetary consequences of a potential event by its probability. The amount by which the maximum potential loss, 60 million, associated with the event exceeds its weighted amount is called the unexpected loss. Compare this. This 60 million for the whole information system, it is how much higher than 44.9 million, the difference between them is called the unexpected loss. Over and above the expected loss. Any loss over and above the expected loss is unexpected loss, and that's B. What is unexpected loss? The unexpected loss, also called the maximum possible loss, is the amount of potential loss that exceeds the expected amount. Okay? Or to put it more precisely, so that you have fuller understanding for a single event, because it says for the single event, so let me do for the single event. Just take this example, Forget about this. There is no event like this. Only consider this event. No event like this. I'm considering currently only a single event, that is unauthorized viewing of internal databases. Okay. The probability of occurring of this event occurring is 35%. Money. And unauthorized viewing of internal databases, in that case, the probability of loss is 50 million, which means the expected loss, 50 million times 0.35, is 17.5 million. This is the expected loss. This is the expected loss of this event. What if the actual loss turns out to be 22 million. This is higher than the expected loss. By how much? 4.5. This 4.5 million, the amount by which the loss is higher than the expected loss, is called the unexpected loss. Okay? So that gives you B to be the correct option. Moving on, a phrase self-insurance is often used to mean the same thing as self-insurance is what? Risk retention is acceptance of risk. Risk sharing is risk transfer. They are the same. B and C are the same. And risk reduction, also called risk mitigation, taking some steps, some decision that will reduce the risk. So self-insurance, which is also called risk acceptance, is also called risk retention. Accepting a risk is also called self-insurance. Self-insurance means you will face whatever might come. Moving on, a landlord owns an office building in a major floodplain. Just like you have a piece of plot near Ravi River. The landlord has decided to sell the building to a group of investors. Since the plot is in a risky place, you have sold the plot to some investors. So what you have done basically? The landlord has adopted a risk strategy which can be called risk
transfer.
Risk transfer is risk sharing. Did he share the risk? He avoided the risk. It's risk avoidance. This is कि जान छुड़ाई उसने प्लॉट से कि मैं रखता ही नहीं हूं. इस रिस्क अवॉइडेंस, रिस्क एक्सप्लॉयटेशन होती कि अगर वो फर्दर प्लॉट्स खरीद लेता उसी जगह पे, इसको बोलते हैं रिस्क एक्सप्लॉयटेशन, जानबूझ के रिस्क लेना. और रिस्क ट्रांसफर, ब्रिंगिंग समवन एल्स एंड आस्किंग हिम टू कंस्ट्रक्ट अ पीस ऑफ कंस्ट्रक्शन साइट एट दैट प्लेस, दिस इज रिस्क शेयरिंग. एंड रिस्क रिडक्शन, मे बी यू कुड हैव इरेक्टेड अ वॉल, a high wall that would protect you in case the flood occurs, for example. Moving on, all of the following are potential benefits of risk management. Benefits of risk management. If you have a good, robust risk management system, the cost of capital will go down. You will deploy your resources more efficiently. This is the benefit of risk management. Flexibility in responding to unforeseen circumstances because you are prepared. This is a benefit. But inherent risk is not reduced because inherent risk is the risk that is in the business because of its nature. Natural risk to business, this is called inherent risk. Moving on. Which of the following is not considered a key step in the risk management process? Yes, we do prioritize risk. Which risks are more serious? We do formulate risk response, which risk to accept, which risk to avoid, which risk to exploit. Assess risk means assessing their financial implication. How do we assess risk? The probability multiplied by the significance with dollar amount. This is called risk assessment. But reconsider current risk, this is not the step. Have you read this term? Reconsider the current risk. This is inappropriate. B is the wrong. Next question number 8. A firm can mitigate the risk of financial loss from the possible on-the-job injury of one of its employees through. One of your employees gets injured. He gets his hand amputated.
It's a liability.
He will file a suit against the company in the court of law. The company may be required to pay the money or to compensate that injured employee. Which insurance or which of the following options will be needed for this to manage the risk? Hazard insurance related to floods, fires, earthquakes, hurricanes, etc. This is not the hazard insurance. Worker compensation insurance. In case an employee loses its job, the insurance company will compensate for the loss of the job. This is a different domain. When you say, and one again, the key employee insurance. Key employee insurance. Your chief executive officer is very crucial for the success of the business. And he is 99 years old man. And he's terminally sick, for example. So any insurance on important employees of the company for their health is called key employee insurance, the employees that are crucial to the success of the organization. So we insure some of the aspects of their life, maybe their health insurance or maybe their physical injury or something. This is key employee insurance. But this liability insurance, something that is my liability. For example, I am oil processor, I mean edible oil, Dalda, for example. If one of my customer gets seriously sick because the oil was contaminated, he filed a suit against me in the court of law, and I'm required to pay $2 million as a compensation. If I have this arrangement with my insurance company, that if any of my customer gets sick and if there's a case against me, the insurance company will compensate the aggrieved customer. This is called liability insurance. If any of my employees gets injured and he files a suit against me in the court of law, any compensation that I have to pay for the injury, the insurance company will pay. This is called liability insurance. Liability insurance means anything that is my liability as a seller or as an employer, but this liability is to be paid by the insurance company. This is called liability insurance, and that's D. Moving on. Oh my God. What this question is doing here? This is not the question that you should be doing now. But since it's here, we cannot avoid that. All right. Before we read this question, just cross this question out. I would like to describe few terms for this question. Very interesting. You will study all these terms in your chapter 5. Financial instruments, derivatives. Okay, let's discuss them. Let's see what they are. Azil, let us consider that you are a mill owner. And you need regular supply of wheat. I am a farmer. I grow wheat. So in the financial management, in the derivative market, a person who has a commodity or will have a commodity is said to have a long position. I have long position. Kis mein mere paas long position hai? Wheat mein. Ye cheez in detail se padhenge, don't worry. I have long position in wheat. Because I have lot of wheat, or I will have a lot of wheat, maybe in a coming few months. You as a mill owner, you need wheat. So you have a short position. In the financial terminology, you have short position in wheat, of course. You have short position in wheat. Now there is risk involved, since it's risk management, and this risk management alone is not helpful unless you mix it up with chapter 5. You read certain derivatives, options, swaps, forwards and futures. These are the instruments we use to manage risk. Now I am as a farmer, I have long position. You know what is the risk I am facing? To me the risk is that prices may fall. And when the time I go to the market, the prices are lower, I lose a lot of money. This is why many farmers commit suicide. Because by the time they bring their products to the market, the prices are lower and their cost of production is not recovered even. This is the risk. On your side, as a mill owner, as a flour mill owner basically, you're a flour mill owner. You have short position And the risk you are facing is that what if the price goes up? I may have to buy expensive wheat and then use those grains to sell the flour. How do we do it? How do I manage my risk? How do you manage your risk? So there is just one term that you need to remember, that the person who has long position in wheat goes for a short hedge. What is hedge, by the way? You know what is hedge? Hedge is a protection. So a person who has a long position goes for the short hedge, and a person who has short position goes for a long hedge. What they are, we will read about them much more in detail in your chapter number 5. This is just for the sake of this question, because just I can't skip this question. So I just can't skip this question. So now if you read this question, it will make sense. So just the thing that you need to memorize and remember, the person who has long position goes for the short hedge to protect himself against the price fall, and a person who has a short position goes for long hedge to protect against the price increase. Okay, here we go. The question. A farmer's cooperative in the US and in the civilized world, I must say. Civilized world. We are not civilized, by the way. In the civilized world, farmers form cooperatives. They help each other out. Because there are 1,000 farmers. If a single farmer go to the market to buy pesticides, it will cost him more. If 10 go together, they might require some quantity discount. If 1,000 farmers give a single order to the seller, the price would be lower. So when we are together, we are strong. That's the idea. This is why in the West they have farmer cooperatives. They do everything collectively, the cost per farmer goes down. So that's the case here. A farmer's cooperative has large amount of grain that has been gathered from its members. The cooperative has a common storage and has stored it in silos. What are silos? Punjabi mein they are called padolas. Padola in Punjabi. So padola is something like this. A big container, and you store your grains in this padolas. And padolas in English called silos. Remember that. So what they have big silos, and they have stored all their grains in those silos so that they can bring it to the market and the price is good. The prices for grain are high right now, but none of the cooperative's customers. So it means these farmers have long position because they have grain with them. They have long position. Their risk is that what if the price falls? This is the risk they are facing. So prices currently are high, but none of the cooperative customers is prepared to purchase any of the next 3 months. In order to hedge against an unfavorable change in the grain prices over the next 3 months, what if the prices fall? They don't want to sell it right now. What if the prices fall? The cooperative will employ a financial risk management technique known as the short hedge. A person or a group of persons that has a custody of an asset, it is said to be they have the long position. If I am the seller of iron, wheat, I have long position. I have substantial quantity of this item. I am having long position. I protect my position through a short hedge. A person who needs wheat, he is short of wheat. He needs wheat because he will use this wheat to convert it into flour. So this person has short position and he will go for a long hedge. So remember, for the sake of this question, a person who has sufficient quantity of something is said to have long position, and he protects himself from the fall in price through short hedge, which means A is the answer. Just for the sake of this option, we had to read and construct the whole situation. It is coming in detail in your chapter 5, risk management. The derivatives instruments we use to manage risk. Moving on, question number 10. Which of the following calculations does not employ statistical techniques such as normal distribution? We use statistical distribution for cash flows. We use statistical distribution like normal curve for earning distributions. And This in fact is called value at risk. So we use statistical methods called the normal distribution, the Z tables, for cash flow at risk, earning distribution, net present value of the project. This method is called value at risk. Capital adequacy is not a statistical model. Capital adequacy means, do you have sufficient money that you can pay to your depositors and the loan seekers? So capital adequacy is simply to what extent you have funds available. So there is not statistical model applied to this D. So this D is beyond. This is not a statistical technique. Okay. Moving on. Which of the following is not a key component of COSO framework for enterprise risk management? Those eight interrelated components. Information and communication was there. Internal environment was there. Control activities was there. But risk mapping was not a part of those eight interrelated components. Elements of project risk identification. How do we identify the risks faced by a project? Elements of project risk identification include which of the following? Includes which of the following? Remember the question. Elements of project risk identification. We are identifying risk. Risk identification. Cost estimation is not risk identification. Actual risk events occurring is not risk identification. Actual duration estimates, how long the project will last, is not. The risk identification is interviews and observations, seeing what is going on, what can go wrong, interviewing people. So C is an element through which we can identify the risks faced by the organization. Moving on to question number 13. The question, a large multinational company currently has its information technology department located in Germany. To reduce the risk of system failure, the company decided to split up the information technology department into two geographically separate locations and set up a new location in Singapore. So just to reduce risk, they have split the information technology department geographically. The company can still face a catastrophic system failure. Why have they done this? Why have they divided their IT department into different? This is to reduce risk because there's a risk of fire, flood. So if your all information technology equipment is placed in one location, what if all is destroyed? So you need to relocate it in different positions so that if one facility goes down, you have another facility to run the business. The company can still face, still there is a risk. The company can still face a catastrophic system failure, but the risk will be greatly reduced. The risk that remains after the company sets up the second information technology department in Singapore, you have, this is called residual risk. The risk that remains even after taking some steps to reduce the risk that remains is called residual risk. Business risk is the business makes lower profit or a loss. Hazard risk because of natural calamities. Inherent risk is the risk because of the nature of the business.
Sir, what is
hazard risk? Tufan, zalzale, barshein, Panama Gate. Moving on. All right, question 14. A toothbrush manufacturer has noticed a shift of customers' preferences in its growing Asian sales market towards an electronic battery-operated toothbrush from a manual toothbrush. So people are moving from manual toothbrush to electronic. I'm sure you've seen a one, electronic toothbrush. So this shift of customer tastes best represents what type of risk to the toothbrush manufacturer? It's a business risk that business either makes low loss, low profit or loss because of the business activities. This is something that has happened, not because this is not the fault of the business. This is the change in the external economic environment and the taste of the customers that has changed this context. There will be a loss, yes, but this is not because of the businesses. This is because of the change in economic factors or the taste of the users. It is not financial risks, not interest rate risk. It is not operational risk. We don't see any operation failing. It's a strategic risk. Change in customer tastes, preferences is a strategic risk. Moving on. A company has developed a new technologically advanced paper thin solar panel for residential home use. A new solar panel that is very thin and is technologically much advanced than the competitor's products, the company has decided to start selling this solar panel worldwide next month. As this is a technologically innovative product, one risk that the company faces to sell the solar panel is possible product failure. What if the product fails? This risk of product failure is best representative of what type of risk? Inherent risk is the risk because of the type of the business. Operational risk is the risk because of the operations related to business that operate the business. Residual risk is the risk that remains after taking all the risk mitigation steps or sharing or transferring or acceptance or avoidance. And business risk is the risk that the business earns less profit or loss. Look at the statement again. One risk that the company faces to sell the solar panel is possible product failure. Product failure could be categorized under what? It is not inherent risk, which means you can cross this out. It is not a residual risk. Now, if you have to guess, you have between B and D. Operational risk or business risk? Operational risk or business risk? So which of these do you think appears to be more suitable?
B.
It's a product line that can fail. So it is not from the external environment, which means it's not strategic risk. It is not some operational risk. There is no administration, selling or marketing. There is. So it has to be then
business risk.
Why? That a company may have lower than anticipated profit or will incur, then it has to be. What is wrong with operations then?
Okay.
I don't find anything wrong with the operation. Let us read maybe why we got it wrong. Operational risk is related to enterprise ongoing everyday operations. It is the risk of loss from inadequate or failed internal processes, people and system. These failures can relate to product failure. Okay, if the product failure is because of the failed processes of the company, maybe manufacturing was faulty, maybe the research was faulty. So if the product is failing, okay, that makes sense now. If the product and information is a little ambiguous, if the product is failing because the internal processes were not effective, in that case it's an operational risk, but there is no such indication. If the product fails not because the processes were faulty, then it's a business risk, and business will make low profit or a loss. Anyways, there is ambiguity. Moving on, question 16. The best description of scenario analysis as a risk analysis technique is that it is a method. Scenario analysis, what is scenario analysis? We construct various scenarios. And then we analyze each one separately and then select the most appropriate one. Changes in a key variable to assess the impact. Like this is the net profit figure. Net profit figure depends upon various things. Direct material, direct labor, variable overheads, variable selling, fixed selling, variable administration, fixed administration. I keep on changing them up and down and I see how they impact net profit. Changing these variables and to see how they impact net profit, which of these affects the net profit the most, this is called sensitivity analysis. And you will study a little bit of sensitivity analysis in your unit 10, section E, investment appraisals.
In part 2.
So A in part 2. It is part 2, by the way. The changes in key variables to assess the impact of net profit or net present value. This is sensitivity analysis. We are talking about scenario analysis, which means this is incorrect. Applies predetermined probability distribution to estimate risky outcomes. Use of probabilities and financial impacts is expected value analysis. It is expected value analysis. C. Evaluate the impact of changing a group of assumptions. group of assumption. If this together, this is the scenario. So this is basically the scenario analysis. See. Did we read this anything related to scenario building in your theory? That's why doing MCQs will elaborate what you have read so far. So MCQs are very important, crucial for success.
So what is your
combines negatively correlated assets to reduce. This is called risk diversification. How does it work? For example, in the first 6 months of the year, in the six hot months, I sell juices, shakes, and during next 6 cold months, I sell dry fruit,
coffee.
So don't you think these businesses move in opposite direction? If one of the business does well, other is going down. If the other is going well, so they support each other in bad times. This is called
diversification.
You will study about this. This is called risk diversification. So combining negatively correlated assets, they are negatively correlated because if one goes up, the other goes down. So combining these investments together to minimize the risk, this is called diversification, and it is in your syllabus, chapter 4, risk and returns. So D is not the answer. In fact, D is called risk diversification. Moving on, question 17. Which statement below best indicates the order of risk components that should be implemented in a new ERM program? ERM program. Which statement below best indicates the order of the risk components that should be implemented in a new enterprise risk management program? Control risk, set risk management strategies and objectives, and monitor risk after they have been implemented. Let us read a better arrangement. They must be in the sequential order. The first thing first, second thing second. Communicate and monitor. Monitoring is done after the risk responses have been set. This is incorrect. Monitoring is the last one. If you remember the word crime, monitoring is the last. So this is incorrect. Assess risk. Control risk. There is no treat risk. Set risk management strategies and objectives. You are setting the strategies first and identifying risk later. How can you do that? Objectives cannot be, you have to first identify the risk, then you have to move on. Risk strategy, how you will manage risk. For that, you have to first identify what are the risks. Only then you can determine what is the right strategy to manage risk. Again, this is incorrect then. So appears that the control risks, set risk management strategies and objectives, and then monitor risk, to what extent are they functioning? Again, what did I do wrong this time? Maybe I need to read this again, maybe among BCD. Communicate and monitor risk. Again, monitoring is the last step. Assess risk, control risk. Treat is not an appropriate word. Treat risk, we haven't read this term. It means BCD are not possible. Then if you just look at D again. Set risk management strategy and objectives. Identify risk and assess risk. This could be possible, but I was little worried about objectives. No doubt are the first, but strategies to manage the risk is after, once we have identified the risk and how to manage them. Again, let us read D. It appears D is the correct option. Set risk management strategy and objective. Objective setting would be the first step, no doubt. Set risk management strategy. How would you manage? This is not the risk response. If this is not the risk response, then that is the right answer. Which risk to avoid, which to accept, which to exploit. Set risk management strategy and objective. Objective must be done first. Identify risk, what are the risks we are facing, and then quantify this. The next step would be risk response. Remember, what next step would be? Risk response. Which risk to accept, avoid, or exploit? And the last step would be monitoring. So there were just words that are confusing, because I was wondering that the risk management strategy might be, he means risk responses. D is the right answer. So it was, first the focus should be on objective, identify risk, assess risk, prioritize risk, then select a suitable response, and then monitor. So the word strategy was confusing here, because strategy doesn't mean here the risk response. So D is the right option. Moving on. A company identifies supply chain risks. Supply chain is one of the operations in the business. So a company identifies supply chain risks. What is supply chain? We read in part one. All the processes and activities involved right from the purchase of raw material till it is delivered to the customer. As a part of its enterprise risk management process, after identification of this risk, the company wants to determine how much of an impact this risk could have on its objectives. Its risk assessment should focus on what? Both inherent risk and residual risk, yes. External but not inherent, no. Only expected events, what about certain unforeseen risk, is unforeseen events. And residual but not inherent risk, no. Both inherent and residual. What is inherent? The risk that emerges from the nature of the business itself. And residual risk, the risk that remains after all the risk reduction, transferring have taken place, all the responses. A company wants to be the best in class in terms of enterprise risk management. Okay. You have to read very carefully. See, a little misreading of terms can result in incorrect responses. We got two questions incorrect because there was just one word that messed things up. A company wants to be best in class in terms of enterprise risk management implementation. To achieve this goal, the company plans to identify events that affect the implementation of strategy and achievement of objectives. Which of the following best reflects an analysis that would help its identification process? We want to identify risk. How do we do that? Risk identification. Which of these options will help us best in identifying risks? Review of accidents and operational measures. This is monitoring. Analysis of default histories and dispersion. Again, this is from the past. We want to identify the risks. Summary of driving records and age. This is not a measure to identify risk. Look at this. Review of incidents and new market conditions. What was and what could happen. So these are the existing risk inventory, and the market conditions will serve as a base to identify newer risks. So these are the sources through which we can find out and identify further risks. So D is the right answer. Next, all of the following are key components of COSO framework for enterprise risk management, except objective setting is there. We have four objectives: strategic, operational, compliance, and reporting. Risk assessment is a part of it. Risk response is a part of COSO, but risk retention is one of the responses. COSO does not recommend which response. The response that whether to retain, accept, or exploit, this is totally depends upon the circumstances we are in. So A is not the part of COSO framework. A doesn't, the COSO framework doesn't endorse which response is more suitable. Moving on. Which of the following is not considered a quantitative assessment of technique? Which of them of the following is not a quantitative risk assessment technique? Quantitative means involving numbers. Which of them doesn't consider scenario analysis? Does consider a number. If the cost goes up by 5%, the sales goes by 10%, there are numbers involved. Cash flow at risk is a statistical model. 100% numbers are involved. Benchmarking, standard setting, comparing your performance with the, again, but self-assured assessment questionnaires. These are the question responses. How well the risk management process in place. So these are just the questions that are distributed among the staff members. This is also called the soft controls. Soft controls mean making people more responsible rather than applying strict controls on them. Make people responsible for controls rather than implementing stringent controls. Benchmarking involves numbers. Cash flow involves numbers. Scenario analysis requires numbers. But self-assessment questionnaires, it's not a technique that involves numbers. Moving on. Communicating information related to risk is very important in enterprise risk management. Okay. Which individual is most likely in the best position to recognize problems as they arise related to customer product design needs? Customer product design need. Risk manager is far away from customer. Internal auditor has no operational involvement. Production manager will only produce what you ask him to produce. He is far away from the users. But sales representative, he is directly interacting with the customer. What customer wants, he is the one who will know first. So which means B is the correct answer. Next. A CFO at a manufacturer of computer equipment learned last week that the accounting department has not completed any bank reconciliation for the last 6 months. Terrible. Due to the implementation of new accounting software package, what type of risk has been identified? It is not a financial risk. Which risk it is then? Operational risk. Operation has failed. Reconciliation is a business operation. It is not hazard, it is not something from external environment, it's C, operational, failed business process, people, system. A corporation has established a risk management process to help it create, protect and enhance shareholder value. Risk management enhances the worth of the investment of shareholders in the company. Which of the following reflects the best order for that risk process? As I told you, objective setting was always the first. But look at here, objective setting is given the second priority. Here third and here the second. Since objective setting has to be the first because it is at the top, then even identification, risk assessment, responses, and then last monitoring. So it means A is the correct chronological order. What we messed up in the previous question was this strategy, risk management strategy. By strategy, I thought it was risk response. So you have to be very clear on the terms. Next question, number 25. Enterprise risk management is closely aligned with corporate governance because it focuses management's attention on the risk mitigated. The ERM is closely aligned with the corporate governance because it focuses management attention on the risk mitigated. No. It focuses on the whole of the organization as an enterprise level, not just on single department. It reduces the level of acceptable risk to be taken. It cannot reduce the level of risk. It's a system that helps the management to decide for themselves what is the right risk to be exploited, the right risk to be shared, to be reduced, and to be avoided. Identifies and isolates the silos in which the risk exists. Silos. It doesn't split the risk in various, it doesn't follow departmental approach. Compartmentalization, it doesn't follow. It takes the risk as a business as a whole. We didn't see any departmentalization. Did we see finance, marketing, and commercial or administration? We didn't see that. It's for the whole business. Again, this is incorrect then. Then what is the ERM model? It identifies which of the organization objectives is at greater risk at the whole organizational level. So B explains this perfectly. Moving on, and I guess this is the last question. A new apartment building was almost complete. There were a few inspections left to pass and they did not have a certificate of occupancy. A new apartment building was almost complete. There were a few inspections left to pass, and they did not have a certificate of occupancy. What does it mean? However, the owner felt that they were close enough, the construction is almost complete, and that he allowed new tenants to begin moving in. Even the construction process is still continuing. There are some inspections. Once the inspections are over, only then the tenants could be asked to bring their stuff and start occupying the position. So a new apartment building was almost complete. It is not complete fully. It's still in the phase of, it's almost about to get complete. There were few inspections left to pass. These inspections are needed. Once they are done, only then the tenants could be asked to come in. And they did not have a certificate of occupancy. Still, you do not have the certificate that now the building is ready. You're taking a risk. However, the owner felt that they were close enough, that almost is done, that he allowed new tenants to begin moving. Come on, building is okay, you can start occupying. That was the risk. The risk that the owner has created in this situation is best described as what? It is not a strategic risk. There was nothing wrong with the external environment. Again, strategic risk, no. Operational risk, because the remaining inspections could not determine that the building is uninhabitable. It is an operational risk. Why? Because we know operational risk is because of failed operations, people, processes, system, and failure to follow the law. Failure to follow the law is also an operational risk. So we do not see here anything related to the operational risk. Operational risk is because of the failed people, processes, systems, and failure to follow or comply with the law. So it says operational risk because the owner was not in compliance with the laws and regulations. That's why A is the correct option. I would like to show you. The risk of loss from failed internal control process, people, and system is operational risk. It includes legal and compliance risk. Since you are not in compliance with the occupancy law, so it's an operational risk.
Yes, sir.
And that, my friend, ends your unit 1.